I'm Justin Rowlatt, I'm the BBC's climate editor, and I'm going to be explaining how heat pumps and fridges and air conditioners really work. So this is a heat pump, and it does something that appears miraculous. For every unit of energy you put in here, you can get up to 3, maybe even 4 units of heat out, which makes it what? 300-400% efficient. Now you're thinking, how is this even possible? Well, that is what I'm here to explain. Now, if you're thinking the heat pump looks a bit like an air conditioner, that's because it is. Heat pumps, air conditioners, fridges and freezers all do the same thing. They move heat from one place to another, and there is nothing new about the technology. It has been around for years. The first fridge was invented by this man, Jacob Perkins, a British settler in the US, almost 200 years ago. So how do heat pumps do it? Well, you may have heard people say they work like a fridge in reverse, but be honest with me, you don't know how a fridge actually works, do you? So here is the science bit. Whoa. Buckle up, because University College London have given me access to their fabulous laboratories to take you on a journey into some of the weirder properties of matter and some of the fundamental laws of the universe as we dive into the science of the heat pump. Whoa. Right, to get things started, let's look under the hood. Right. So it looks very complicated, doesn't it? But it's actually quite simple when you know how it works. All you need to know at the moment is this network of pipes is all sealed up and it contains a magic fluid called a refrigerant. Now the refrigerant is key to how the whole thing works. Now, back to the fundamental laws of the universe. Heat pumps rely on the second law of thermodynamics to operate. That decrees that heat moves from something hot, like me, to something cooler, like the air all around me. It's why your coffee gets cold, and it's why ice melts. Now, they use this law to move energy, move heat, from the outside into your home. They can do it even when the air is literally freezing outside, sub-zero. And they can do it so effectively because they exploit a very peculiar quality of matter, something that happens at what is known as a phase change. So what is a phase change? Now, a phase change is when matter changes state. So it goes from a solid to a liquid, liquid to a gas, or back the other way again. And something odd happens to materials during a phase change. The energy you put in stops heating them up, or more precisely, the energy you put in stops making them hotter and goes into making the phase change happen. What do I mean by that? Well, let's take a kettle, fill it up with water. So when your kettle is boiling away, the energy is going into breaking the bonds that hold the water in a watery state. It's not getting any hotter, but it's got a whole lot more energy in it. And that energy, that stored energy, is known as latent heat. Materials can store a lot of latent heat as they go through a phase change, and it's all that energy stashed away that heat pumps use. So we've seen how much energy it takes to boil water, but lots of other materials turn into gases at much lower temperatures, like this stuff. This is dry ice. This is frozen carbon dioxide. Look at this, put it in there. Whoa, whoa, God, that's great. So dry ice turns into a gas, turns into carbon dioxide at minus 78 degrees Celsius. And we can see it, look at it, turning into a gas before our eyes. So why do materials like dry ice turn into a gas at much lower temperatures? Well, it's because the bonds between the molecules are much weaker. With water, the bonds are much stronger, which means the boiling point is much higher. Heat pumps use all sorts of materials as refrigerants. Some use materials called HFCs. Back in the old days, they used CFCs, but both of those are quite damaging to the atmosphere. So increasingly, they're using more commonplace materials, natural refrigerants. Some use propane, some use carbon dioxide. I'm gonna demonstrate using butane in this can, which is very similar to propane. And I've got a thermometer here to show you something rather special. So the butane is a liquid in the can, but its boiling point is minus 36 degrees. Release it from the can, get it boiling, and ow, that really hurt. And you can see the temperature goes down, in fact, to minus 40. So think about it. There is loads of heat, even on a really cold day, even when it's sub-zero, to get the liquid boiling, to draw in all that energy, all that heat. Oh, right, let's take a closer look at our heat pump. Now this bit down here, this is the evaporator. That's where the refrigerant is sprayed out into the network of pipes at the back. So it's minus 36 degrees when it's released, remember? Now, take a look over here. We got the fan. What the fan does is it moves the air over the pipe, giving it lots of opportunity to do what we know the second law of thermodynamics says it wants to do, move from warm to cold. So it's warming up the refrigerant, turning it into a gas. And if we follow the pipe, the refrigerant, now a gas with all its molecules jumping energetically around, moves down through this pipe to this bit, the pump bit of the heat pump. This is a compressor and it does what the name suggests, it compresses the gas. So what happens when we put our refrigerant under pressure? Well, you've probably experienced something similar when you pump up the tires of a bike. Your pump gets hot, doesn't it? And we can demonstrate that with this. So we've got a tiny bit of cotton wool at the bottom and effectively what we've got here is a piston. I put that in there like that. Lights off, please, Miho. And look at this. Whoa! So what is happening here? Well, when we push down the piston, concentrate the air in here, the molecules get closer together, don't they? They're interacting more, bumping against each other more, and that raises the temperature. And the pump in the heat pump does the same thing, raises the temperature of the refrigerant, releasing the heat that it's harvested from outside. So now the challenge is to get that heat from the refrigerant into your home. Whoa, and that is done by this bit of the heat pump. This is the condenser. So the hot refrigerant in this pipe passes through another pipe that contains the cold water from your heating system. Quiz time. What does the second law of thermodynamics decree will happen? Yep, the heat from the refrigerant passes in to your heating system, giving you a warm home or a hot shower, which sounds like the end of the story, doesn't it? Except I've missed out one crucial property of matter these clever machines exploit. This last property relies on the fact that the boiling point is not just about temperature. Let me show you. So we've got a flask full of water here. I've got a pump, which I'm turning on, and the pump is gonna suck the air out of the flask, and we're gonna see what happens to the water, which is at room temperature, as I release the valve, sucking the air out of the vessel. And look at that, it begins to boil. So what's happening? Well, if you think about it, in the atmosphere above us, there's loads and loads of molecules stacked on top of each other, pressing down on a pan of water. Lift away those molecules, create a vacuum as I have here, and it begins to boil much more easily. I can check the temperature, and it is 18 degrees Celsius. So it is basically room temperature. Now we can experience that without creating a vacuum. Picture now, Edmund Hillary and Sherpa Tenzing on top of Everest. They stop to make a cuppa, they put the pan on the stove, but because the pressure's so much lower on top of Everest, the water doesn't boil at 100 degrees Celsius, but more like 68 degrees Celsius, which gives them a problem because that isn't hot enough to draw the flavor from the tea. Water needs to be more than 90 degrees Celsius to do that. They do have one advantage though. They can basically drink their tea straight from the pan because we normally drink tea, interesting point, at about 65 degrees Celsius. Now let's look at the other side. Let's look, instead of lowering the pressure, at raising the pressure, what happens then? And I have here a pressure cooker. Now what the pressure cooker does, as the name suggests, is As the water boils, it traps the water vapor, and that pushes down on the liquid, making it harder for it to boil and raising the boiling point. We can see the pressure here. Whoa, look at that. And we can also see that the temperature is higher than normal boiling point. So it is 114 degrees Celsius instead of 100 degrees Celsius. That is why that extra heat is why your food cooks more quickly in a pressure cooker, and it also uses less energy. So why is pressure so important? Well, let's quickly go back to the butane. Remember, it is liquid under pressure at room temperature. Spray it out, gets very cold, expands, draws in heat. That gas, now full of latent heat, goes into the compressor, is pressed down, the temperature rises, we put it in the condenser, and it releases, the refrigerant releases its heat into the water in your heating system. So now it's cooler, and it's also under pressure, so it becomes a liquid. And there's just one last process you need to know about. Right, last bit of the heat pump we need to know about is the expansion valve, and it's somewhere in here. I don't know where it is, but to be honest, it doesn't really matter. It does what the name suggests. It expands, it eases the pressure off, allowing the liquid to expand a bit. Now, we know what happens when we release the pressure. It gives the molecules more space to move, doesn't it? They bump into each other less, they cool down. So now we have a cool liquid refrigerant ready to go back into the evaporator and start the whole process again. Evaporating in, collecting the heat from the air, concentrating it in the pump, releasing it into the hot water in the system, giving you a warm home or a hot shower. Bingo, a heat pump. All super efficient. Remember, one unit of energy in, three, four, some modern heat pumps, 5 units of heat out. And refrigerators and air conditioners, well, they work in reverse, don't they? They take heat from a space and they move it outside. So now you know how heat pumps, fridges, freezers, and air conditioners all work. Feel free to share the good news.